Thanks again for joining us this month's OIT VoIP Presents Partner First webinar. Today we have with us, we're very fortunate to have Laz Gonzalez, CSO, Chief Strategy Officer of Zift Solutions. Those of you that don't know, Zift effectively powers the channel. I mean, everything we use with all our vendors is powered by Zift most of the time. Laz, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and what you do over at Zift?
Well, thanks, Ray. Really appreciate that. And a warm welcome to all those partners joining us out there. As you mentioned, I'm Chief Strategy Officer over at Zift Solutions, and we have the ZiftONE platform, which is kind of the end-to-end solution for most channel chiefs out there, helping them everything from recruitment, onboarding, enablement, and even the marketing and the demand gen, which is really what we're going to talk about today. And just a quick intro. Besides that, I was 8 years service director for channels research at SiriusDecisions Forrester, and then a long history working in international channels as a channel chief myself for over 20 years. So hopefully I can bring some of that to the table today and help our listeners and viewers really maximize on some best practices.
That sounds pretty awesome. And today, you know, that fueling business growth, that's something that's so important to every business, period. You know, we talk about people that are directly in the MSP space. It's always interesting to hear the perspective of people that are powering those that are in the MSP space to get that eagle eye perspective, see what works on a macro level. You know, and that's exactly what I look to learn here. As we get started, you know, just wanted to go ahead and show off the technical issues. Sorry, I thought I had that on screen. I want to go ahead and start off with a poll here. And the poll is going to be very simple. I just want to ask a quick question for those of you guys. What's the largest percentage of companies' annual revenue coming from? If you don't know these numbers, we talked last week or we talked last month specifically about identifying those numbers and why they're important to know. So I hope everybody took home the homework and started to pay attention to it. So we're going to do the same thing here. We're going to see what we learned from last month and how we could apply it to what we're doing now. I'll give a few more seconds for that, get a few more answers. But we're seeing a lot of renewal business seems to be the most common answer. And we'll close it out. And let's see what we have here. We have renewal business being 100% of the largest annual revenue. Laz, are you seeing that? Is that matching what you're seeing on your end?
Yeah, I mean, renewal business right now for companies is number one priority, and that means maintaining that that customer in a long-standing relationship where they can upsell and cross-sell. So yes, absolutely, going back to that customer and trying to, you know, maximize the revenue opportunity with them and share a wallet is huge right now.
Awesome. And with that, I'll go ahead and stop sharing so you can take over.
Good. Okay. So, you know, Ray and team asked me to share with you some thoughts on really digital marketing and what's happening out there. And when I first did this, Ray, you may remember I told you a story of talking to business owners. So business owners at partner organizations that are faced with decisions, right? They have to think about how am I going to grow revenue for my organization? And, you know, most of them, the reaction is, you know, let's look on the sales side. Let's grow pipeline by going out there and generating sales and having a salesperson knock on doors. But what I will say is that there's a perfect storm going on right now. On the one hand, you've got the buyer, and the buyer is changing every which way in terms of how they're connecting with sellers and how they're consuming content and how they make buy decisions. And on the other hand, you've got business partners that don't normally invest in this area, invest in digital marketing to generate that pipeline and leads. So that to me is a perfect storm. And today, I hope if you're out there that I'm going to present you a compelling argument that if you had to make a choice between, you know, do I hire a new sales guy or do I start leveraging some digital marketing, that in your mind, this session today will open up your eyes to how that digital marketing can make an impact on your business. And I'll check back at the end and make sure, see if I've convinced anyone.
Looking forward to that.
Right. So to that point, Ray, what I had in store was to talk about these buyers and how they're changing. How should partners out there react to these changes? And then talk about some best practice, you know, what's working, what's not working. So if you'll allow me, I'll just go through that for the next 20 minutes or so.
Awesome. Looking forward to it.
Excellent. All right. So let's start with the first piece here, which is, you know, how are buyers really changing, right? And, you know, if you ask any salesperson out there, they'll share with you that, you know, right now, you know, the buying cycle and the sales cycle is not what it used to be, right? It used to be really aligned. Buyers had few opportunities to get information about products and services, and they had to contact the seller to get that. And so that seller was really important. He was kind of driving, right? But today the buyers are really running the show. It sounds to me from the feedback that we're getting from our own sellers that those buyers are much more knowledgeable. They're more demanding. They're, you know, a lot of them wear many hats on the buyer side, and they're consuming a lot of content to inform themselves. And while they're doing this, the seller's trying to do a bunch of other stuff, and those two things aren't always aligned. Right.
So let me ask you a question. You're mentioning the buyers are more knowledgeable, and I'm seeing the same thing. I'm seeing the same thing in the marketplace. Why do you think that is? Do you think it's because vendors are working so hard on educating the masses before selling them, or, you know, because it does shift the power, you know, in the sales process, because now the buyer knows exactly what to ask. They know who your competitors are. They know what they're offering. They're asking you what's special about you. So why do you think that is?
Absolutely. I mean, when we look at performance and campaigns on our own platform and we see buyers as they go through their journey, we see them becoming extremely educated. And, you know, that thought leadership, that customer enablement, making sure that the customer understands and is engaged, that's happening all up front, right? And so by the time they get to that buyer, hey, they've got their opinions. They may have done this with one or two or three different competitors. So I think that's why they're really, it's that consumption and really the targeted approach by a lot of the brands to get that knowledge out there, especially in the tech market where things aren't that easy and there's a lot of explaining to do.
So they're really doing their due diligence. They're shopping around, they're getting educated. Do you feel there's a benefit to being the first in the running, talking to the buyer, or being the last one? Does it make a difference?
Well, look, you know, in the chart that I'm showing here, right? You can see that there is a part of this that's taking place strictly online. And you may not have a chance to be the first or the second to get that influence unless you're investing in that technology, the digital, the thought leadership, the social, to capture their attention. So you need to be first in terms of influence, right? And that's where everything starts. But that doesn't mean that some of the other things don't happen. Right? You got to cover your bases in terms of, you know, the content that you're putting out there. It has to be aligned with what the industry is saying. It's not that the buyer is just going to rely on digital tactics all the time, right? They're not just going to go down here and think about that. They're also going to access communities. They're going to engage with peers. So that becomes something really important. And to your point, Ray, I think what's really happening is that sales is interacting much later. If you think about it, when you ask salespeople, you know, when are you really touching bases with that buyer? And the buyer is in the driver's seat. It seems to them that the buyer is, you know, taking certain steps, and only after, you know, they've done things like concur with their team, you know, engage with an industry expert, consume a substantial amount of marketing, that they'll reach out to that buyer. So there is kind of this continuum taking place, like I'm showing in the slide, where the sales process doesn't start from the seller's perspective, not until that buyer is ready to explore possible solutions, right?
That's super interesting. So, can you step back in the slide 1 second?
Yeah, sure.
Because it's funny because, you know, I talked to, coming from being an MSP myself and then, you know, going into the vendor space, you know, I still have that. We have this large community of MSPs we talk to on a regular basis in Discord and Slack. And one thing we always hear is the MSPs are so tired of the sales process, right? They're tired of the sales funnel, and they want to just go online, have a transactional experience, buy what they need to buy and move on. But what you're showing is the customers don't want that. They want to educate themselves. They want to know what they're doing. They want to do their due diligence. They want to do everything. And sometimes that needs that handhold approach too. The salesperson is a key element of that.
Well, think of the salesperson being the knowledge Sherpa, right? Kind of guiding that buyer through their path and through their journey. And there's a lot of stuff happening, you know, upfront that that salesperson is not part of. You know, as they're searching the internet, as they're, you know, really getting information that they need, you know, there is a lot of content being consumed in that early stage. And the important thing is to know what kind of content. You know, Ray, the biggest mistake I see is companies looking at this and then taking a spray and pray approach, right? Kind of saying, well, I'm in the game and I'm going to start creating this stuff and putting it out there. And what I'm going to talk about today when we get to some of the best practices, you know, timing is everything. You know, making sure that you have the right content to that buyer at the stage that they're in, that's really going to drive success.
That's super interesting. I mean, being able to say, and I get it. We see the same thing. We, especially when you're coming up, if you're not taking this from an educated approach, you're saying, I see everybody else is everywhere. And they're not realizing it's not that my competitors are everywhere. It's that they're directing what they're doing. And I just fall squarely in that niche of who they're directing their marketing efforts at. And, you know, and it's interesting when you're at different stages in that buying process, how the message that's being relayed to you changes. And it's a subtle thing. The buyer shouldn't know the difference that that's happening. It should just be a happenstance. Oh, that's really relevant to me right now at this moment in time. And you're going to show us how to do that. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. I mean, picture it this way. The buyer's out there, right? And the real challenge is that you can create content, but you have to be able to know where to put that content. So think about it this way. Imagine the buyer is going from websites to associations to analyst blogs, whatever it is, right? Your job is to create tripwires that buyer is going to sense, and that's going to happen. And then they'll start consuming some of your content. And then you start directing that path and offering them some webinars, offering them some learning experience, something that they can download. You know, the biggest mistake you can make is go to that buyer and just basically say, hi, I've got a product. Here it is. Why don't you buy it? Right? I mean, it's really funny, but you know, when you look at some of the first steps that even partners take when they start doing some marketing, it's like they're in a rush to sell, right? Now, let me make this clear that there are some services that buyers buy very quickly, right? Because something breaks, they need that back up and running immediately. So they're not going to take, you know, 6 months and nurture and emails and all this stuff to kind of make that decision. That's very tactical, and you want that inbound demand to come in quickly, right? But really, there's a journey out there for the other buyer, right? The buyer that's maybe not just buying, you know, a replacement for something that they already have, but is looking to invest in something like a virtualized infrastructure, or really looking at, you know, how their data and their voice is going to work in their whole environment, right? Those guys are going to consume content. You're going to need to use some outbound tactics once you've identified them to keep them in the loop. And then there's going to be lots of collateral demands, things that they're going to want, side-by-side comparisons, et cetera. And just because they go quiet doesn't mean that they're gone. At that point, you have to stay present of mind. So all of these things, you know, require that you set up a journey. You guide that buyer step by step through this process so that, you know, you could be that influencer. You could be that company that they go to first when they issue the RFP or when they want to call one of those sellers to come in and actually do that.
So these deals are transactional. They last longer, right? These are the ones that are going to stay with you. These clients are going to stay with you 1, 2, 3, 10 years. Those dollar amounts for those contracts are going to be much higher in value because they've put so much effort in. The last thing I want to do is have to do this again to find a new vendor. So there's a significant payoff to putting so much work up front.
Absolutely. And, you know, just like you would think there's a significant payoff in building strong interpersonal relationships, there is a huge payoff in building digital relationships with the buyer. So, hey, Ray, I think we're up on a poll question. So the second poll question is here. Maybe you want to ask
Absolutely. It. Absolutely. So our next poll question is going to be, where do you generate the majority of your leads, right? Is it coming from referrals, from word of mouth? Is it coming from website traffic? You're doing some pay-per-click campaigns or some you know, knowledge-based campaigns? Are you doing digital marketing, your community engagement, or, you know, that dreaded, I don't know. You know, and it's hard because you put so much, hopefully, if you put so much money and effort into doing these marketing, you know, doing these marketing efforts, you want to be able to say, I know where my results are coming from. So I really hope you guys are tagging your leads that come in. But we're going to go ahead and I'll give two more seconds here to finish out voting. We see that referrals are still the highest number here, right? They're the highest number of leads. How do you feel about that, Laz?
Well, let's think about that. Referrals are really important. In other words, a buyer always wants to see somebody like themselves succeeding with a partner's solution, right? So, but the question becomes, will every opportunity know you're there or get your referral? And so what you have to think about is, what other form can referrals take? Can they take the form of case studies? Can they take the form of ROIs, where a customer allows you to say, hey, it's okay, you can say we grew our business and because of you? Those are stories to be told, right? And they would substitute the face-to-face referral from the digital referral. So
they carry that much more longevity, right? I mean, we talk about it. We even do these webinars, and you know, I've been doing these webinars for years. I know you've been doing these webinars for, hundreds of these. And you see it, like, you get the results later on. People tell you a year, 2 years, 3 years later, saying, I saw this webinar, I read this case study you were in, I saw something. You know, it carries Absolutely. That longevity, and it lowers the amount of effort you have to put in, because let's be honest, every time somebody, one of your customers refers somebody else, that transaction, you're not part of it. You're hoping they do it, and you may want to urge them to do it, but you have no control over that. And you definitely have no control over the audience. That's a one-to-one engagement. You build that case study, and I wish I saw more MSPs doing more case studies. They're so important, but those case studies you have, and suddenly you're able to tell a story and say, this is what we did. This is the problem we encountered. This is how we provided that solution. This is how the client benefited. And if you're doing it right, that story is creating engagement for the prospective buyer, where the prospective buyer is saying, oh, that's me. It's a different name on the company. It's a different name that who they're working with, but that's me. That's my situation. And they're doing that much work for you, and it's just as good as a referral, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And you could repurpose it, like you said. That's really important part of all of this. So, but it's great data, and it looks like the partners figured out how to use the polling as well.
Yeah. Learning as we go, man.
Yeah. All right. Well, so we've talked about the problem, the issue, what's happening out there. Why don't we start talking about the solution, right? So I think the things to think about is, how should you react to these new B2B marketing changes that are going on out there? And I'll keep it real simple, right? The first thing is that you really have to understand what's going on in the web. So you have to put your feelers out. You have to understand what the dynamics, read the digital body language, really know what to do out there. The second thing is that you have to also pay attention, or should be paying attention, to the journey that that buyer is taking. And many of you have already participated in that journey in many different instances with buyers, right? People who come in and out of that journey, for example, if somebody's looking to expand their contract, you might have a purchasing person come in there. If you have naysayers or approvers or whatever they are, business folks, understanding who comes in and out, that's going to be really important. And then look, let's dispense with all the branding and awareness things for the sake of marketing, right? I've always, learned that in the channel, you really have to be focused. And being focused means look to grow pipeline contribution, and measure that, right? It's not just saying, it's also doing it. So let's start with the first one, the understanding the role of the web, right? And with respect to the web, there, as I mentioned, there's a new dynamic, right? And we understand that at the top of the funnel, there are two distinct phases. There's this education phase where the buyer is saying, I'm thinking about changing, but I'm not there yet. And then there's the solution phase where, they've made that mental connection and now they're starting to look at solutions, right? A lot of that is happening online. And then you've got the vendor selection phase. That's when they've already determined, they've educated, they've moved forward, and they're starting to engage with your company, right? The important things to understand there is what the buyer is doing during that purchasing phase. And to do that, we have to peel the onion, so to speak, and see who's doing this, right? So you might have people that you know that are champions, and we'll call those champion personas, right? Somebody that we have to pay attention to. There's also going to be influencers. These are people that may not be making the entire decision, but you're going to see them downloading content. You're going to see them engaging in some kind of blog. These are key influencers that you also have to consider. Now, the executives, you'll find that they'll get engaged very early and very late in the process, right? So that means that those high-level messages and those, you know, ROI statements need to be, you know, really focused on that person when they come into that journey. Now, users, as you all know, these are the people who are actually going to be using the services and the solutions, and we want to make sure that we watch their experience. And as I mentioned, you could have people in accounting, purchasing, something like that, that we would call ratifiers. Now, these ratifiers are going to be folks that could really put the stop on things, right? So we don't want to ignore them. If it's financial information, if it's whatever that they want, is what we're going to try and serve them, all right? So now, if you've got this, the next step is to start thinking about what are the key wins for these folks. Now, you might be saying, where's the marketing? Where's the digital? Well, first, you got to do this. You got to plan this out.
Let me ask you a question before we get into that, though. When we talk about, you know, the champions, the influencers, I think there's so much focus when we're in our sales process to say, you know, we're focusing on the decision makers. We're focusing on who's going to make the final yes or no. But each of these has a significant role to play if you're doing this right, right? It's not just a pick one and go. And if you're doing this right, you're communicating differently depending on the role of the person you're talking to. So can you give us some insight on how you would identify these people before you've even walked in the door? I mean, you know, there's always stuff like Seamless and discover.org and, you know, LinkedIn. But when you first say, this is a company I want to do business with, which one of these five are you going after? Which one are you looking for first?
Well, tools like ours are smart enough to start looking at where those buyers are coming from and start watching their behavior so that you get continuous reporting. So let's say you're selling to a company and then all of a sudden five emails pop up because people are downloading things and accessing information, and you've gated that in a way that maybe they have to put their email to receive it. Now they go somewhere else and we're going to track where they're doing that from. And all of a sudden you start seeing different folks. Now you might not know who's who, but what we find is that a lot of partners and a lot of our suppliers that we work with, like you said, they match that up with either LinkedIn or information that they can now track that email back to the individual. You know, that's the forensics of marketing, where you really have to use that data to start picking it up. But I think the best way to see it is by the content that they consume, right? They have certain appetites for information. If it's high level financial win type information, that might be somebody at a senior level. If you start seeing people, you know, start looking at the bits and bytes or some of the technical content that you're putting up there, you could start classifying that and start dealing with them separately. So there's a lot to be said by the information that they consume of who they are, and then triangulating that with some of these tools on a platform like ours, which many suppliers are now offering to their partners.
Very cool.
Yeah. So listen, this is an exercise in identifying who they are and then really just getting an idea of what their wins are, right? So the win for the business executive is going to be ROI, and maybe the win for somebody who is an influencer could be performance, right? Because it's going to impact their day-to-day. And then somebody maybe in purchasing will want to see a total cost of ownership. See, the job is to really get into their minds. So if you're selling to the CIO persona, to your point, Ray, that, you know, you just want to get to the decision maker, you have to really understand what's present of mind for them. You know, what are some of their top initiatives like costs and cloud and things like that? And then what are some of their, you know, biggest challenges like security? Right. And now you can start tapping into that and telling a story. You know, when we look at that CIO persona, you know, what are the things that they do first, second, third? You know, it maps back to the data that I shared earlier. You know, the first thing they do is they look on the web. They start looking at the problems that they're having and what's out there to help them find it. And search becomes a really important thing. Now, let me hit a timeout here. You might have something to say about this. One thing is getting them on your hook, right? So they find you. Another thing is when they come to your website, surprising them with something less than what they expected.
Okay.
So
can you give a, you know, I'm sure you've seen, we don't want to call anybody out, but I'm sure you've seen the good and the bad out there. Can you give an example of, because I mean, sometimes we don't know the mistakes we're making, right?
Yeah.
So can you give an example of where somebody has front loaded, done a lot of effort on the marketing side, but then they got them on the hook, they bring them to the website, and, or why don't we go the opposite way? What's a good example of what we should be showing them on the website? Once they walk in our virtual door, what should we be putting in front of them?
And I think the message here is something that they can connect to by really understanding who they are, right? So if it's the first time, you got to give them some options. Remember, the key thing on that website is not how well you can place products and how well you can tell, you know, the technical ins and outs. What you want to do on that website, the first thing is start telling your story, right? So anybody who comes there understands what you're all about. Right now, you might guide them into certain directions, right? Depending on your offerings. Give those choices up front. But what you also have to make sure is that website is optimized for things like search engines so that you do come up in those early searches. Because here it's showing, this is where they go first, right? So I think the big trap is that, you know, a lot of companies just take content and they'll just talk about product. And the next thing you know, that's not a lot different than their competitor. And so there's no differentiation there. I think the opportunity here is to tell your story and be able to convey that in a way that the buyer walks away with a better understanding of what's going on.
Yeah, especially in the MSP space, I see so many of us, and I was guilty of this, so many of us focused on products and features. And, you know, we did it on the VoIP space too. You know, focusing on products and features and technical benefits and, you know, that's not relevant. I mean, that stuff, yes, you're going to get to in a discovery call and you're going to get to when you do your presentation. But, you know, the story is what sells. You know, so many of these MSPs worry about, I want to look big and corporate. But that's not the point. The point is we're not giant enterprises. We're selling ourselves, our story, our relationship. It has to have emotion tied to it. You know, and I feel, unfortunately, a lot of the MSPs missed the mark on that today in their web strategies.
And to your point earlier, right? If references are going to be important, then, you know, lead with that, right? You don't have to talk about how big you are. You know, they always say the half-filled bucket splashes the loudest, right?
I like that. So,
yeah, it's always better when somebody else is talking about you, right? So why not put somebody up there and say, ABC Company's done this great job for us. You know, just a quote, let them see the value that you're bringing to the table. And like I said, make sure your website is optimized to, you know, and once they get there, they can see these things because that's something that they're going to want. And there's going to be more than one of them. There's going to be plenty of people in there searching for this information. So that CIO person that you might want to be selling to, you might say, I just want to go to the decision maker. Know that there's several people in there. And so, you know, we talked about those roles and how important they are, and then getting into their heads to give them the right content. But let me show you how you put all of this together, right? Because once you've identified this education phase where all of that stuff is taking place in the early consideration, and then the solution phase where now they're looking at product, and then finally that face-to-face where they've actually asked you to come in and they're starting to justify going in your direction or another direction, the key here is to now bring those folks in, right? Understand who's lining up at which of these phases and then bring to them the content that identifies with them, right? So you see how the journey is built. We plug in the people and then we put the content after. And a lot of times what folks will do is, hey, let's do a white paper. They'll put it out there and they'll take a spray and pray approach. And they'll say, boy, that digital marketing doesn't work for me because I put the white paper out there, but nobody really downloaded it, right? So I think this gives you an idea of the kind of information. And this is not to say that that the other tactics don't work, right? Teleprospecting still works. Events still work. Some direct customer marketing still works. But if you think about it, when you look at the size of companies, right, you'll find that in the mid-markets and in the general territories, there's a greater emphasis, right, on digital. And the way I explain this, Ray, is when you're looking at lead sources, where are these leads coming from, right? Think about the company you're selling to. Sometimes that buyer is wearing many hats, right? And they're going out there and, you know, they're trying to get information. They're using digital. They don't have the liberty of having somebody knock on their door all the time. Now, granted, if you're a Fortune 500 company or a Fortune 100 company, you've got an account team that calls on you all the time, most of the time directly from the vendor. But when you're a mid-sized company or a company that doesn't get that special attention, you're much more likely to consume digital content. So that even puts a bigger emphasis on doing this right.
That makes a lot of sense, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's really, you could almost read the tea leaves when you see this stuff. Now, here's something that I think you should take into consideration. I mentioned before that timing is everything, right? And what I've done here is I've laid out a graph, and on the right-hand side, you see all the tactics, all the things that we've been talking about, like assets, things like white paper, peer referrals, webinars, emails, and all those kind of things. And now what I'm going to plot in here, and you've seen, is which of these are most effective in the early, middle, and late stages of that buyer's journey. So if you think about the first stage, right, you notice that here, a lot of the white papers, the peer referrals, and the live events, the webinars, are really important.
Those now, educational pieces, those they're learning about what they're doing. They're doing discovery.
You got it. And that's where you want to serve up these pieces, right? Now, it'll get to the point in the middle where they're doing side by side. And they want data. They want to know how this works against that, or, you know, get into the details. And that's when you can drill down, right? Now, just by showing you this, you know where some of the mistakes are being made, right?
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes this stuff is coming first, and people don't want all that detail up front, right? They're forming opinions, right?
Yeah.
And then at the end, again, you see the peer referrals come back in. It kind of spikes back up. And the third party validation comes up. So you see the analyst reports also come back up. And the reason that's happening is because now they're trying to justify the decision. Okay. So with what I've shared with the buyer's journey, the different personas and the tactics, now we're kind of ready to start thinking about how do you create a program like this? And so, you know, maybe for a multi-touch example would be that you start off by talking about the competitive advantage of doing things in the cloud. Maybe your buyer is a finance buyer, and you might say, here's why finance is moving in that direction. And then finally, one example, and I'm giving some industry examples, and here's what somebody says around a cloud app, why you would be doing that. So you could see it's almost like a three-step process. Now, remember, what might work in finance might not work in the tech industry. So now you have to kind of change your message just to make sure that you've kind of got this in a way that really can help that buyer at those different stages. So, you know,
this is why that spray and pray doesn't work, right? This is why, you know, if you're just putting the same message out to everybody universally, you can't expect a response. You can't expect positive results. It has to be a directed message, tactical and strategic for who you're going after.
The data speaks for itself, right? The data speaks for itself. So there is a certain level of premeditation that's involved here, right? Some homework that needs to be done, right? Now, a lot of you are out there looking at this and saying, boy, this is more complicated than I thought it would be, right?
if only there were experts out there that helped with this stuff, right?
Well, here's the idea, right? At the beginning of this, I said that maybe you should be considering investing in marketing instead of hiring that next salesperson, right? Today, what I've shown you are why this can make a difference, what are the skills that are needed, and how you can take the first couple of steps. Ray, I've got a couple of takeaways that I want to share with our viewers. Want
to jump? That'd be great. Yeah, absolutely.
All right. So, you know, the first thing I want you to remember is that buyers are more knowledgeable. Just get that in your head. They're engaging later with sales. And in turn, marketing needs to step up. They need to step up and build a digital relationship with that buyer. That's what this is really all about. Those programs that we shared at the end, they need alignment, right? The car will not move forward if the tires are all going in different directions. So you need some alignment that will drive the effectiveness, and you need to align to the buying cycle, the different stages that I shared, and also the personas. You know, I often get asked, what's really the best way to approach this? I would say, think about your story. Think about your story first, and then think about the marketing tactics that would support that story. And if the story starts with an excellent customer reference, then that's a great place to start. Look, you're all here today, right? You're looking at all of this. You can't just sit there. You got to do something. I would say that the time is now. You know, you can't wait for this. You know, while you're here, even on this webinar, there's a buyer out there thinking about, you know, forming an opinion, buying a solution, and so on. You want that message to reach the buyer almost like on automatic pilot. So I say act now, because every minute is another buyer going through that and really trying to look for something that you might have to offer. So that concludes my part of the best practices, Ray. I wonder if you know, you want to go to some QA?
Yeah, I would love to. I mean, you know, and I appreciate it, Laz. There's so much stuff you've given us that's so important today. It's just, you know, we think about it and you see the same thing. I mean, I can't tell you how many times I'll see on MSPRS, IT Pool Party, Reddit, on the MSP sub, the same question comes up. Oh, you know, we're growing. I think we're ready to hire a salesperson. You never see the, I'm ready to hire a marketing person. And based on what you're explaining, if you do the job right, if you're strategic, you're directed, you're conveying the right message at the right times to the right people, the sales portion of it is so much easier, I would think. Because there's less work, because the customer is going to get educated no matter what. I mean, whether you're doing it or whether they're doing it online, whether you're doing it on the sales call or you're doing it on the website, the customer is going to demand education. There's zero question about it. You want to be the one delivering it to them because you don't want them getting it from their vendor, right? You don't want to get their, or your competitor. You don't want them getting it from somewhere else. And unlike sales, that you have your one-to-one approach, marketing, you have that one-to-many where you can, you know, it's directed, it's strategic, but that marketing message that goes out, if you're doing it right, you're hitting thousands or tens of thousands of people, you know, with the right message, and you're just making your job that much easier. So, you know, I might even argue, and I'd love to hear your opinion on this, but on these smaller MSPs, the guys that are 10, 15, 20 people, you know, maybe it does make sense to hire marketing in-house first, or even outsource, whatever works for you, but hire a marketing solution prior to engaging that, hiring on that sales team?
Well, I mean, you've got the feedback already if you're running a business of that size. And if you've got, you know, even if you're doing your own sales, right, you know, getting that next lead is terribly difficult. If you're doing your own business development, you know that you can't do business development and run an effective business at the same time. So naturally, your first reaction is to create a clone of yourself, right? Somebody with the professional look and feel and can carry the dialogue out to the customers. But, you know, very quickly, what's going to happen is that that person is going to say, well, you know, I need some marketing muscle. I need you to feed me some leads because, you know, the days of cold calling are out, right? It's even in existing accounts, there's a lot of customer marketing that needs to take place. And so whether you went sales first or you went marketing first, they need to coexist. And one thing that you should think about is you're going to create one pipeline, right? Both sales and marketing have to contribute to that pipeline, right? So depending on your customer, each one may have an even share, or you might find that marketing is just going after some of the big accounts and contributing 30, 20%. It all depends on who, you know, the size of that type of customer.
To get an idea, I mean, what size marketing, and I know this is a really hard question to answer, so I apologize, but, you know, is there a ratio as far as, you know, because unfortunately, if you're a 20-person company, right, usually you have the CEO or some one of the principals acting in sales capacity, you have some techs, you have maybe some HR billing if they're not outsourced. Right. Where's the sweet spot? Should I be bringing on, you know, one marketing person to every two salespeople? Should I, at minimum, you know, do I need to have a dedicated web person, a dedicated, you know, case study white paper person or communications, right, for social media? You know, What does that marketing team look like for a company of that size? Or is there an all-in-one type person?
Yeah, that's a tough question to ask. And I would say, yes, all of those things that you said, you're going to need, right? You're going to need the content to put in, you know, your efforts. And that means that you're going to have somebody to create that content, whether you hire an agency or you bring somebody in to do that, unless you can also create white papers on the fly, which is very difficult. So I think that that's one way to answer is to say, yes, you need these pieces. But I'll offer a different perspective, right? Start with your customer, right? Think of the pyramid, right? And at the top of the pyramid, you've got those big accounts, right? Marketing is going to be less effective sourcing leads in those big accounts. You're going to need to, you know, lead with sales. And marketing may play a backseat supporting sales with events, with collateral, with things that they would deliver to those big accounts. Now, look at that pyramid again, and if you're starting to see that your business is coming from a broader set of accounts, not just large enterprise accounts, but companies that you don't really have a relationship with, then you're going to ask for more contribution from marketing. So now you might say, at the top of that pyramid, I might need 70% sales, 30% marketing. But now in the middle, I might need 50-50. And now if I'm going down to the smaller companies, remember the smaller companies, person wears many hats, doesn't have a vendor calling on them, has to consume a lot of content, they're going to be even more dependent on marketing. So now you might find that at the lower end, you might be 70% marketing and 30% sales. So that's kind of how I would look at it. I would look at your customer first. Who are you selling into? What is the requirement from both sales and marketing, and then adjust that way? Because, you know, you don't want to build a team that doesn't have a market for itself out there.
Absolutely. So, and with that, I'd like to get into some of the questions that are getting put in. And by all means, guys, if you have any questions, now's the time, you know, put them in there and we'll absolutely try to get through all of these. One of the first questions I see, I have a lot of partners here that are other also VoIP service providers. You know, one of the questions I ask, when you have something that, I don't want to call it commodity, but you have something that's so ubiquitous, right? There's so many VoIP vendors out there, you know, but you're saying don't spray and pray, despite VoIP being ideal for so many markets. How do you choose? How do you choose what's the right target to go after when you're something as ubiquitous as like a VoIP vendor?
So the question is more on the customer targets and trying to sell them a commodity type solution, right?
Right. If we're starting with saying focus on the customer first, right, the target customer, how do we determine what that ideal customer should be if we have that commodity type product that we're selling?
Yeah, I think you also have to look beyond the commodity type product here because, I mean, every partner out there is trying to differentiate themselves, right? So I don't think that you tell the product story to your customer. I think you tell your story to the customer. So at the end of the day, it's not, you know, MSP1 selling one VoIP solution against MSP2 selling a similar VoIP solution, that it's a company here who has experience with small manufacturing firms in northern New Jersey, and they have a track record of success, and they're telling that story. So they want to continue that and look at maybe an adjacent market. Somebody who would respond to that. Maybe it's not manufacturing, but it might be distribution. And those folks might have similar needs. I always fall back on the customer. You know, I had a challenge like this once selling a commodity product. And I remember we were selling help desk software. Help desk software, you know, so many choices you can have out there. And I really started looking at it from the customer. Who needs this most, right? Who can't live without this thing? Right? And what can we offer that's different than what somebody else can offer to that organization? And at the time, the organization that I was with offered, you know, follow the sun, 7x24 support, which is really unusual. But we also had some airlines, right? So we had airlines customers running the help desk. So we had to be, you know, up and around all the time. So I figured it was going to be hospitals, right? If I'm looking for a customer in my patch, then I went at it that way. And so I think that, you know, we were uniquely suited to serve that customer. And I think that's where your viewers have to start. you know, rather than the product commodity story, it's their story and thinking about how to get to the customer with that unique, you know, solution.
Absolutely. And, you know, and looking at something, you know, like you shared here, your key elements to success slide, it seems like a lot for somebody that's smaller in size, right? That 5, 10, 15, or 20 person MSP. So we talked about selecting the right client. I'm all about that. You know, anybody that's heard me talk has always heard me say, success is more about client selection than it is about anything else you do in your business. And we talked about starting with a story, and there's a couple ways to tell that story, right? Whether you're saying it in a written form, in a social media, in video form. But let's talk about that story. What part of that story do you figure, or what delivery method do you see that works better than others? We see video thrown at us over and over again. Do video. Not everybody's set up to be able to do that. Where should they be focusing their efforts when they're just starting to create that story?
I think, you look at the top up here where it shows inbound tactics, just to kind of differentiate, right? Inbound tactics is not email that you're pushing out. It's people coming to you. And the reason that they're coming to you is because you're telling that story in the right place and they're finding you. I think social is one of those places where you can tell that story right away. So, you know, you do something like even LinkedIn marketing, right? You know, creating posts on LinkedIn and tracking that network that way. Or it doesn't even have to be your site. It could be your contribution to, you know, a blog or an expert opinion with some links to it as well. I think that is where people are most receptive to hearing the story. Where they're least receptive is if you just blast an email with a great, set of content and it sits in their bin and they never look at it. Right. It's something that you got to try to, you know, be where they are. And that's why I showed those, you know, let's look at it this way. Tell the story at the watering holes that your buyer goes to enrich themselves with information. That's the key.
Absolutely. I've spoken a lot about that myself. I'll talk about, you know, identify your target client, identify, you know, who you figure you're going to suit best, then figure out where they're hanging out and then go hang in those circles, go become a subject matter expert in those circles, become the guy they want to talk to in their circles.
Exactly.
You know, you need to do a little bit of cyber stalking, but you know, thankfully LinkedIn, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, they make it so easy to do today. So it's not hard to find out what's important.
There's not one sales rep out there that doesn't know how to use these tools today.
Absolutely. And we're seeing the success of that. I mean, you have tons of case studies, looking over the Zift Solutions website. You do have tons of these stories out there, and it's not just a white paper of this is some things we did and this is what we accomplished. It's a story of how we got there. What was the pain point, how we identified the solution, how we executed. And I want to go back to our takeaways, you know, guys, because this is so important. We talk about this stuff and it's easy to miss and say, yeah, we need to do marketing. We all know that. We all know Laz is giving us the how. And if you want to shoot us an email, shoot me an email. I'll put our contact information up. I'd be more than happy to share this slideshow as well. And I'll put our contact information. Sorry about that. A little tongue tied today. I'll put our contact information up there as well. But shoot us an email if you want copies of the slide share. We are going to post a copy of this webinar. Unless I see any other questions come up, I'll go ahead and close it on that. Laz, thank you so much for taking the time to show this to us. Somebody with your breadth of experience, your time in the industry, and your accomplishments. It's rare air that we get to partake in today, and it's so important showing how the big players do this, how they accomplish it. And now we get to take this home and take the takeaways and see how we can apply that to our own scale. So thank you very much, man. I appreciate it.
You're very welcome, Ray. And thanks to all the partners for joining us today.
All right. With that, have a great time, guys. Any other stuff you want to, any other guests you want to see, any other topics you want us to discuss, my information is there. You know how to find me on Reddit. You know how to find me on Discord, on IT Pool Party, or by email, or just pick up the phone and give me a call. I'm always available. But have an awesome rest of your week, and we'll see you on the next one. Take care. Hey, guys. Thanks for watching. For more videos just like this one, hit the subscribe button. Don't forget to hit the alert icon so you get notified of new videos, or check out some of these videos below.